Today I want to talk to you about the UL 4600. This is a quite interesting standard because it's not from an established standardization organization, so ISO, IEC, SAE, but rather from a testing laboratory, and it's focused on evaluation of autonomous products. So this is less on the engineering side and more how to evaluate, argue for the safety of autonomous systems in focused on the automotive, but being more on the general side. They see themselves not as a sort of conflict or contradiction to established standard, but rather as a necessary extension for autonomous system. So functional safety, yeah, we focus on the engineering, we focus on faults, and we try to ensure that the system is safe even if a fault happens. And for classical systems where we have a user, where we have a driver, this is completely fine. But if you move towards automated system, then this is a little bit different because there's a certain percentage of correct and incorrect actions. So a vision system will detect a person, not always, but depending on the environment. And that means that even without a fault, accident can happen. And for that, we have SOTIF, and there is so far, before the UL 4600 come out, not really a way to bring this together and to build a complete safety case. And even more importantly, if we have then some communication or some updates in the systems, there's also cybersecurity in place. And if we go from a safety case to this assurance case, then it becomes even more difficult. And therefore, they considered it necessary to have such a standard which focuses on this assurance safety case concept specific for autonomous systems. And they see themselves not so much as a competitor with the automotive functional safety standard or with the automotive safety intended functionality standard, but rather as an extension. So they made a mapping what's covered by the different standards, and for them they have here a stronger focus on this actuators, this body controls, but even more a focus on the safety case for this. And therefore, they also see themselves as reusing and connecting the arguments. So basically, they more or less envision that the engineering was done based on existing safety standards, and the UL 4600 gives a sort of a guidance how these artifacts from the engineering can be used to argue for the safety. Scope is here. This is also important. When I presented the SOTIF standard, I said they are not for fully autonomous vehicles, so they restrict themselves to a level where there is still a human driver, where the human driver can still control the vehicle and take over the control. For the UL 4600, they really go to fully autonomous vehicle, no human driver involved. And also focus on this system level safety case. So how can you argue for an automated vehicle which is driving in the open environment that you achieved a sufficient level of safety. And for them, this is done by having a combination of analysis in order to identify what scenarios, what situations. Then using simulation, closed cross testing, and public road testing. So these three approaches to water testing. And with this, if it's sufficiently done, and if the argumentation is enough, they claim that there can be an appropriate level of system safety to be achieved. As I said, this is really intended as a sort of a supplement and as addition. For the automotive domain, these are mainly these two standards, but they see themselves as rather application domain independent, meaning you can also use other safety standards. If you're not working on vehicle, but on drones or other systems, what they try to build up is really this way of how you can argue the safety. And for that, they use claim-based safety case and build up a framework, how to achieve a consistent and complete safety case, and how to assess such a safety case with a focus on automated system. What they obviously have not, therefore this connections to existing standards, there is no engineering process. So they're really focused on the safety case and on this evaluation. There is also this awareness that such a safety case has to be assessed and reviewed. So simply following the standard does not yet ensure safety. And if there is some human supervision necessary, so the whole human-machine interaction, or if there is some specific functionality involved, then this is restricted. In a way, they make the life a little bit easier, because if you have the topic of human-machine interaction, shared control, you always need to consider how long does it take for the driver to become aware of the situation and take over the control. And this issue they avoid by saying, okay, we are not in our scope, we don't consider products that rely on human supervision. What they include, what is normally not considered in the classic safety standards, machine learning faults. So if in your approach towards machine learning, there is already some existing fault, if in your pipeline, there is some issue, so external operation faults, and other topics which are more towards the AI autonomy area. So they see themselves also a little bit as a sort of how to make a safe AI for automated systems. And obviously, the ARDIS feature itself, how to engineer it, this is out of scope. But also, we had before these three pillars: simulation, closed course, safe road testing. And while they require safe road testing in the safety case, they are not giving any requirements how road testing can be done safely. They point here to a British standard, which focuses on the safe testing of automated vehicles. So not the safety of automated vehicles, but the safe testing. But also say this is out of the scope of the UL 4600. Ethical guidelines, so all these issues. If an accident cannot be avoided, what action should the automated system take? Out of scope. Human Vectors, so spanning from human attention to predicting human behavior to if the human interacts, is his action reaction correct out of scope. Also said before that they say for a complete case, you need to consider the security, but obviously this is evaluation safety case argumentation standard. So the approach towards security, the security engineering itself, how to plan security, how to map security to safety, this is all out of scope. So they require approach towards security, but they do not give details on how to approach the security topic. And to have a simplified view, how they see this safety case, what is needed? The first thing is there is a need to have the context defined. That means on the one side, we need to define what is our system. And system here includes not only the vehicle, but also the infrastructure around. And we then also need to define the operational driving domain. Operational driving domain is a concept which tries to describe all environmental condition under which a driving task can be automated. So obvious example, if I have a lane keeping and there is no road markings, my lane keeping will not work. So my operational driving domain for lane keeping will be a street with road markings. If I have a camera-based system for detecting these lane markings and this camera-based system is not working if it's dark, my ODD will be road with daylight and lane markings. And so with specifying under which condition this automated function is working, they try to minimize the number of variables and the number of scenarios they have to consider and restrict this to a level where the safety can be argued. Obviously, development, operation, processes, safety culture is also included in the context. This needs to be ensured. Without having the development operation issue handled, safety cannot be achieved. And the next thing is the identification of hazards. And here we already see some well-known, well-accepted things. So fault models, vehicle, system and software. This is all contents we expect from a classical safety perspective, which is also contained in the 26262. But there are also some additional. So the autonomy pipeline, the data networking services, so considering all the dependencies, also potential misactions from other road users, and then even topics ranging from maintenance to inspection. So they really try to cover here hazards not only existing due to issues in the vehicle, but also in the complete surrounding from a time perspective, so covering the vehicle from production until decommissioning, but also from an environment perspective. And if this is then handled, so if the hazards are identified, then they can be mapped to the measures. So basically what was done to manage the risks, to mitigate them. And this also ranges on the one side to the classical, I have a hazard, what is my response to this? But also how can I ensure, how can I have a safe leaving of my operational driving domain? That means for lane keeping, if there are suddenly no more road markings, no more lane markings, the system should not immediately stop functioning. There should be some sort of ensuring that there's a safe handover. And obviously, they accept that there are scenarios which we will encounter during the lifetime of a vehicle, which are not foreseeable at the start. And here, this is this feedback to manage unknowns. So how to, on the one side, handle such situations, but on the other side, also how to address this issue, not on a single vehicle, but on a vehicle fleet level. And then obviously, the general structure of the safety case. So are all elements contained? Is the traceability there? Can the logic be followed? Are there metrics contained? Basically, ensure that this three parts, the context, the hazards, and the risk mitigation fits together. And while this general approach to the safety case is obviously well known and well accepted, from my point of view, specifically the hazards which has to be considered and the risk mitigations is something which is quite unique to this approach and extends more towards a holistic view on system level safety than existing safety standards. In general, if we want to try to define a sort of life cycle for the standard, then we basically want to define a safety case format, how it's structured high level, what type of evidence. We want to have the risk assessment. We want to have the content for the safety case. So basically to fill the structure with evidence, with traceability, and then we want to assess it. But as I said, since this is not an engineering standard, but more really an evaluation standard, this lifecycle is not a strict lifecycle where step has to follow on step. The goal here is really to have this safety case in a way that it can be assessed and that it is more or less sure or has a high confidence in this safety case. For the safety case itself, for the format, they recommend a graphical representation with the argumentation that otherwise the overview and the understandability is difficult, using something like GSN. And that an important part of this format is also to restrict and identify the system scope. The system scope, or this operational design domain, considers infrastructure, weather, road, own other vehicle conditions, and important also a strategy how the ODT can be stopped. So if I leave the ODT, what has to happen? Risk assessment, as I said, they are going really above the risks considered in the other safety standards. They also consider few novels risk analysis methods. So they use the STPA stamp approach. They want to include the human interaction, not really on the level of how the human takes over. As I said, this is out of scope, but more how the human is interacting with this automated vehicle as a driver of other vehicles which could have an unpredictable behavior. They want to tackle the whole life cycle. So this also includes replacement of age components and even considers topic like if a sensor gets dirty and has a reduced efficiency, reduced performance, how this can be handled. And then obviously for the safety case itself, the traceability is important. They try, this is always with such assessment quite difficult because every person has its own opinion and its own specialties, and therefore two assessors might come to different opinions, but they try to have here an increase in the repeatability of the assessment and to have a sort of package. So they have the safety case with a sort of manual on how to read this. And to point out a few topics which I find very interesting in the standard and why I think that this is really an interesting approach and a good extension to the existing. They have at one of the first standard really this topic of safety-related maintenance. So basically, if you have some camera systems and the safety of your vehicle is related to these camera systems, are you required to wash your vehicle once a week, once a month? One example here, I have it depicted. Tesla's had one radar sensor, and there was the case that a quite big bug hit this radar sensor, and the radar sensor could not send through this bug. And so, yeah, the automated functions in this Tesla stopped due to a real-world bug. Other things is also, so for example, we have now here the first washing system for cameras, where there's basically a small washer which tries to keep the cameras clean. And this is really, for me, showing that this concern in the UL4600, that the safety case has to be valid at all times. So how is the not only manufacturing, but also the operation done? How is the update done? If are there some inspection? So if you have your yearly inspection, should this check some automation sensors? That all these topics discussed in the UL4600 will probably be quite important. If I have a windshield which is completely dirty and I cannot see anything, the police will stop me. If my cameras are completely dirty and the vehicle cannot see anything, this is currently not considered by the police. So I think we will have there many topics to discuss, which are already now discussed in this standard, but which will become much more important for us when automated vehicles really reach the mainstream with a high level of automation, with no human supervision. And then we suddenly have to discuss, how can we check if the cameras are still clean enough? And obviously, what they accept, there are events, there are situations which cannot be detected. There are things which are completely out of the expectation, where we have scenarios which we did not consider realistic, and suddenly they are there. They try to cover this by having a very detailed checklist, which contains more or less all things which happened so far, which were published in automated driving. But they also say the checklist cannot be complete. So the system has to be monitored. If there is something happening which is unexpected, this has to be transmitted back, and there has to be checked if this leads to an unsafe behavior or not. This is meant with this deploying with uncertainty. These vehicles will be rolled out, assuming they are sufficiently safe, but this is only an assumption. And the systems have to be monitored to ensure that this assumption stays valid, and there's a high chance that situations will happen which will challenge these assumptions. Developed was a standard by a quite interesting mixture, ranging from research to industry. And also one of the first standards which really included quite a high number of insurance companies, because they are very interested in, if they have to insure such vehicles, what can they do to check to insure only safe enough vehicles. And this for me is also one point where the standard is a little bit special, that it really has this strong insurance evaluation scope. From the security domain, there's the common criteria, which is a security evaluation standard, but from the safety domain so far, there was no standard which focused really solely on this evaluation. And I think especially with this focus on evaluation, on safety case, on automated systems, the UL460 is a quite interesting addition to the standards. And for everybody who's working on automated system, on safety case, I can only recommend to go through it. It could contain some interesting additions. So far from my side, I see that I have used almost completely the time. So if there are some persons who have questions but need to go to the next meeting, I'm also open to questions via email. Otherwise, thank you very much for the discussion, and I will be here for a few more minutes for discussions.